Tefano o te atua, no mai haere mai. Welcome to Church Online, the 2021 edition, and welcome to my whare. Currently peaceful, although that might change at any moment. Kids might bash through the wall or through the door. It's happened before. This isn't the first take. I just want to welcome you all here this morning for our church family from Morrisville Baptist Church. I hope you're all doing really well, and that you've got everything you need. For those who might be joining us who aren't usually part of our family, I just want to say welcome. It's great to have you here with us. My name is Tom. I am one of the pastors. I'm the assistant pastor at Morrinsville Baptist Church, and I hope that everyone is well and that your families are doing okay. I know for some of us life just continues as usual, but I know for others this will be a really, really tough time. And I'd encourage you, if there are things that are going on where you need support, feel free to contact your small groups or your small group leaders. Know that the church staff, we're still working. We're still working, albeit from home. We're still available. So please get in touch with us. You can call us as you would normally through the church phone number, and just hit the extension number, and that will direct you through to our cell phones. It'll redirect you out here. We are available, but because of the fact that we're in lockdown through till Tuesday, the church building is closed. It's completely closed, except for with the exception of the Ezekiel Trust Food Bank and budgeting, which is by appointment only. And I'll throw something up on the screen so you can see that. Yeah, with the government rules, the new rules about wearing a face mask when we're out in public and going into places. If you are in need of a mask, if you don't have one, we do have a limited supply available. So get in touch with Alana and she'll try to get one into your letterbox. But I am, from what I understand, if you go to New World or to Countdown and you ask, they will provide you with a mask as you come in the door. Yeah, any questions around that, any confusion, just get in contact and we'll try and help you with those things. If you've got kids, we're not going to run a kids program online here this morning, but I have put some links on our Facebook page, so you're more than welcome to go have a look on there. I'll pop them up on that community Christian page as well. Just some videos and some resources that might be useful today and anytime with our kids. Some really, really neat stuff. And if you find anything that you think's great, please send it along so we can share that as well. We've got a few things going on this week to try and help us stay connected, even though we are physically disconnected in some ways. So tonight we have a Zoom prayer meeting, which is going to run from 7:15 to 8:15, and you'll be able to connect to that via the Zoom link. We will place that up on Facebook following this, and hopefully send that out via our email if you're part of that list. If you want to be part of that and you don't have access to either of those, you can email Richard at seniorpastor@morrinsvillebaptist.com or flick us a message on Facebook or whatever it might be. Try and get in touch with us and we'll add you to that. Likewise, on Thursday morning, if we are still in lockdown, we will run a Zoom prayer meeting. That'll be from 5:30 a.m. through to 6:30 a.m. And again, we'll make those links available on Facebook. There is a daily time of prayer that you can find. It's called Lockdown Karakia, and I'll post the links on both the community page and the Morrinsville Baptist Church Facebook page. But that is a time to pray for our global brothers and sisters, and praying really that there's an awakening of the Spirit, that there's a renewal of God's love, you know, in people's lives. If you have a prayer need, and I know there'll be many out there, if there's stuff going on, please send that through to the prayer chain. And likewise, if you'd like to be part of that, part of the team that's praying, our faithful prayer warriors, please text your name through with maybe just the word join to that phone number, and we'll add you to that. And yeah, the podcast. So I know many of you will be flat out with kids and farming and various things like that, but there might be some of you who've got a bit of time up your sleeves, or maybe you guys are just wanting to plug in and hear some of the things that you may have missed throughout the year or listen to it again. Our podcast is available. You can search it on Spotify or Apple or the Google podcast platform, or follow the links that I throw up on the Facebook pages. This may be a very unsettling or difficult time for some of you, and although we have each other to support us through this time, and our desire might be to love one another as God has loved us. You know, we're here to support one another, but ultimately the greatest source of hope, the greatest source of comfort and confidence is found in our all-powerful, unwavering God. You know, this is a time where the devil will instill fear into the hearts of mankind. But our Lord, you know, he's defeated the enemy. And we need not fear, for God, he is with us. And Isaiah 41:10, we're told, "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And I really enjoyed reading on the 180 youth page. You know, Kelly posted a verse. It's something that's been very special to many of us. But James 4:8, which tells us that if we draw near to God, he will draw near to us. And you know, if you don't know Jesus, if you have never experienced what it is to be in relationship with him, I can only imagine how unsettling and troubling this time must be for you. But for those of us who do know him, we have the incredible privilege of being able to draw near to God. And Philippians 4:6-7 tells us, or reminds us, not to be anxious about anything, to trust God in all situations, in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving we need to present our requests to God. And the peace, this is the result, the peace of God which transcends, that is above all things, the peace of God that is above all things, above all understanding, will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the incredible opportunity we have through technology to be able to meet together this morning. And I just pray, wherever anyone is right now watching this, whatever the time might be, Father, I just pray that your peace would be upon those people and in our hearts, Father. Lord, we want to commit this service into your hands, and we pray that it would be encouraging, but also, Father, that it would bring challenge into our lives, encourage us to walk boldly and confidently in who we are as sons and daughters of the living God. And Father, may we rise up and hold you in our hearts with confidence, Father, that your name would be proclaimed, Father. So Lord, we want to commit the service to you, and we ask that your kingdom would come and that your will would be done on this earth as it is in heaven right now. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Welcome, Morrinsville Baptist Church, to our message this morning as part of our online Chime service. It's mixed feelings that we're doing this. We're great for the technology, but we really wish we could be meeting in person this morning. But God's a living God, and he will be with us wherever we gather. And that's one of our encouragements. We do pray that this will be temporary, and that we'll be soon back gathering together and worshipping our Lord and encouraging one another together. In the meantime, let's just pray as we just commit this time to the Lord. Father, we thank you for your word that is living and active. We thank you, Lord, that it does not return void. And so, Father, wherever we are gathering to listen this morning, we ask your spirit would be among us and work in us and through us this day. Lord, may you speak to us, encourage us, build us up, that we might become more like Jesus each day. So may your spirit be at work, and Lord, illuminate your word to us as we read, that we may know you more deeply and see you more clearly and be able to follow you with all our hearts because of our love for you. So be with us now, and we thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your goodness. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we've been going through the Gospel of Matthew since February, we picked up on some of the key themes, and one of them was the lifestyle of the kingdom, which was really wrapped around the Sermon on the Mount. Jesus came to show us what it was like to live as God's people. He put on flesh and showed that to us. And then the Sermon of the Mount was about explaining what that looks like as a person who's been transformed by Jesus Christ. And we have to remember that he's talking in the context of God pouring his spirit out onto us, because that would be pretty challenging, we all know, without God's spirit, Holy Spirit, changing and transforming us. And that's a really key point to remember. And we'll be talking about the Holy Spirit again this morning. He's essential in helping and enabling us to follow Jesus. We're just quickly setting a little bit of the background. Jesus has been demonstrating the kingdom. And as he has gone around, back in chapter 4, he spoke about preaching and teaching and traveling around and healing many diseases and sicknesses. That's one of the marvelous things. After the Sermon on the Mount, he healed a person with leprosy. Then he would also heal the servant of a centurion, Roman centurion. He calmed a storm on the Galilee, and his disciples were amazed. Two non-Jewish demon-possessed men were healed as Jesus went out of their territory for a while. He forgives the sins of a paralytic man, and so that evidence of his authority was the man was able to get up and walk and carry his mat. He healed a woman who had been bleeding for 12 years. He raised the daughter of Jairus from the dead. And then he healed a man with who was not only blind, but he was deaf as well. And that amazed the people of Israel when they saw Jesus able to do that. And that was in chapter 9. And the Pharisees noted then that this power must come from a source other than God. And they quickly attributed it to the work of Satan. And so then Jesus gives his power and authority to his disciples and say, just as I've been going out, I want you to go and do the same. And so they're out doing that. And Jesus then connects his miracles and his mission together and draws them in line. So this is what the prophet Isaiah said and others about me and about the Messiah coming. And again, just in the run-up to the passage we're looking at this morning, Jesus upset the religious leaders in a grain field when they considered what Jesus was doing as work for his disciples, and then Jesus healing a man with a shriveled hand in a synagogue on the Sabbath, and they quickly took that as meaning that Jesus was breaking the Sabbath rules. And so quickly coming into conflict about rightly understanding God's laws. And so Jesus is saying the evidence that he has the authority of God the Father is the miracles that he is doing and his care for the people. So let's pick that story up now in Matthew 12. I'm going to read from verses 22 down to 32. So Matthew 12, 22 to 32. Then they brought a demon-possessed man who was blind and mute, and Jesus healed him so that he could both talk and see. All the people were astonished and said, "Could this be the son of David?" But when the Pharisees heard this, they said, "It is only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons." Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. If Satan drives out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then can his kingdom stand? And if I drive out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your people drive them out? So then, they will be your judges. But if I drive out demons by the Spirit of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Or again, how can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can rob his house. He who is not with me is against me, and he who does not gather with me scatters. And so I tell you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven men, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. Anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but anyone who speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, even this age or in the age to come." So very quickly, Jesus is facing another confrontation with the religious leaders. And they're accusing him. And that's on the basis here in verses 22 and 23. When he heals a blind and mute man. And the people were astonished by that. Now what was significant about this healing, as in the one at the end of chapter 9, is that Jesus healed not only a blind, but a deaf mute. And we'll just come back to that in a moment. And so the people are astonished and say, "Could this be the son of David?" And see, Jesus was affirming his authority and power here was directly from God the Father, and the religious leaders there were being challenged by that. And Jesus said at the end of chapter 11, I think, which Dave Johns touched on, is that Jesus' power and authority came directly from God. And at the time of Jesus' ministry on earth, the people there in Israel had developed a major list of signs of what they expected the true Messiah to be able to do as proof of his identity. One was healing leprosy, and Jesus had done that just right after the Sermon on the Mount. Another one was to be able to cast demons out of a deaf, dumb and blind person, because they couldn't speak and mute. And so that was a pretty significant thing that Jesus was able to do that, because how could you engage with a demon? When Jesus encountered the two demon-possessed men across the Lake of Galilee, they spoke to Jesus, "What do you want to do with us?" And Jesus dialogued with them. Here, there can be no dialogue with a demon because the person can't speak. Well, very much at the beginning of this passage, Jesus is again in conflict with the religious leaders. And here he heals a man who is both blind and deaf. He can't speak. And so Jesus heals him of a demon. And the people are astonished by this, as they were at the end of chapter 9 when Jesus heals another man in a similar situation. Because Jesus here is affirming his power and authority comes directly from God the Father, as he had touched on at the end of chapter 11. And so the people are so astonished by this miracle and others that they say, "Surely this is the Son of David," as a question. Because by the end of the first century, by the beginning of the first century, the people there of Israel were expecting the Messiah to come so desperately. And they had a list of signs that they believed that the Messiah would be able to do to prove his identity. One was healing leprosy. And Jesus had done that straight after the Sermon on the Mount. Another was being able to drive out demons from someone who was both blind and deaf, mute. Because if we consider the situation, Jesus went to the other side of the Lake of Galilee and he cast out the demons, collectively known as Legion, into the pigs. He dialogued with them and they said, "What do you want to do with us?" And Jesus cast them into the pigs then. Well, how could you call a demon to leave a person if he couldn't speak to it? And that's why it was one of the signs of Messiah. He would have the authority to do that. And so the people were astonished. And like in chapter 9 here, the Pharisees, the leaders, don't know what to do here. They can see this is a supernatural happening. And because they don't believe Jesus is the Messiah, they have to attribute his supernatural activity to be coming from the prince of demons, to Satan. And they say it's only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this fellow drives out demons. That was their response. And Beelzebub is just really... it's a term that's been picked up from an old Canaanite god that they worshipped, and they've just changed it to mean Lord of the Flies and attributed to Satan. And so they're trying to now say that Jesus' miraculous powers may not be coming from God, because they want to support Jesus' ministry and his teachings. And that's the only way that they can justify how Jesus is doing this without saying, "Yes, this is the Messiah, this is the Son of God." And so they dig their heels in. And so in verses 25 and 26, Jesus knew their thoughts, it says, and says that every kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and every city or household divided against itself will not stand. For if Satan drives out Satan, he is divided against himself. How can his kingdom stand? And so Jesus is challenging them and says, "Well, why would I want to drive, if I'm one of Satan's people, why would I want to be attacking my fellow comrades, fellow soldiers of the kingdom?" So Jesus attacks it, and one attacks their logic. And one way to consider that is, if you went back to the Spanish Civil War, a phrase became famous called a fifth column. When a general was approaching Madrid in that Spanish Civil War. He came with four columns coming from four sides. And as he was boasting to a journalist about their victory, he also said that there was a fifth column of supporters, but they were actually inside the city. And they were a clandestine force. They were doing it in secret. They were undermining those who were defending the city and trying to demoralize them and help sabotage the efforts of those defending the city of Madrid from those coming along. And in one sense, they're saying the same thing of Jesus. But Jesus says, that's foolishness. Why would Satan fight against himself? And Jesus, in the midst of this, affirmed that Satan had a kingdom, which Satan indeed offered to Jesus at the time of the trial in the wilderness. And Paul says that Satan is the god of this age, and that we live in this present evil age, even after Jesus has ascended. And so if Jesus had entered here into Satan's kingdom as a secret soldier on his behalf, why would he attack his other supporters of Satan? It wouldn't make sense. Think of the All Blacks. It's a bit of a silly example, but hopefully you'll get the picture. All Blacks trying to beat Australian rugby. And imagine if one of the players decided he wanted to help Australia win. Although he was wearing an All Black jersey, he might drop the ball or make some poor passes that were intercepted. Maybe he might say some words to discourage his fellow teammates that we can't beat these people, they're too hard for us. In one sense, that's what would be happening in terms of undermining from within. And of course, we all know that that's a crazy example. No one putting on an All Black shirt would ever want to support Australia or help them win. And so, but that's the kind of example that Jesus is giving to them and exposing their foolishness. And then Jesus will go on the attack. And in verse 27-28, we know that Jesus has already given his authority to his disciples, because what he did, he then told his disciples to go out and do. And he says, how can anyone enter a strong man's house and carry off his possessions unless he first ties up the strong man? Then he can rob the house. And so Jesus is saying here, he has come. He is the one who has the power to defeat Satan. And that's part of his mission. And that's wonderful news. And if Jesus' identity is true, he has the power to cast out demons by the Spirit of God. And that God's kingdom is now come in power and in his authority. And that's great news for us. And so by driving out demons, Jesus is proving that he is greater than Satan. He was able to go into Satan's realm, the strong man's house, the demonic world, and come away with the spoils of victory. That was his mission. And since he could do this, he was also able to inaugurate the kingdom of God being among the people. And so if he was driving out demons by Satan's power, he could certainly not be offering God's kingdom to the people. That would be contradictory. The fact that he was now coming to establish the kingdom clearly showed that he worked by the power of the Spirit of God and not by Satan's power. Jesus had absolute power over the demonic world. And it was a matter of authority that his father had given him, as he said at the end of chapter 11, not some kind of magic or sorcery. And so verses 31-32 has seen a lot of debate about what does the unforgivable sin mean, and a lot of ink has been spilt over that, and many a debate over that. And so you'll find books and books and books about these things. And we're just going to touch on that this morning. There's much more we could say, but not today. But I think it is quite simple when we read the message. But let's just navigate our way through that. Jesus talks about blasphemy, and blasphemy is something serious. It's slander against God. And so the Jews saw this with utmost gravity because God had revealed that to him and through his commandments. For he is a holy God with a holy name. And so here Jesus makes a distinction between that slander of the Son of Man, who is him, which is forgivable, and slander against the Holy Spirit, which is not in this age and in the age to come, which is kind of pretty scary. I'm sure you'd all agree with me. And so what was he talking about? Well, we do know when a sinner turns to Jesus, that their sins will be forgiven in a normal way. And when they repent and put their trust in Jesus. And so sins of this kind are serious. But if they're not repented and not forgiven, they will have eternal consequences. But Jesus said on the cross, Father, forgive them, those who have done this. And so Jesus had a forgiving heart to those who had rejected him there. And so these sins are certainly forgivable. So here's what I highlight three possible scenarios, and the one that I think seems right and appropriate and sensible. Well, some have said that this unpardonable sin could have only have been committed while Jesus was carrying out his earthly ministry, and that the Spirit was testifying to his work. Some of those we just heard of earlier at the beginning, when Jesus was doing amazing miracles, and only those who were rejecting it then did this apply to. Others have said that that sin is unbelief, and that when that continues until the time of death, it means everyone who dies in unbelief, or at least everyone who has heard of Christ and then dies in unbelief, has committed this sin. And so it's rejecting the work of Jesus Christ. Another view, which I think makes much more sense, is that this sin consists of unusually malicious and willful rejection and slander against the Holy Spirit's work, who was attesting to Christ and then attributing that work to Satan. And a closer look at the context of Jesus' statement here in this passage shows that Jesus was speaking in response to accusations of the Pharisees that it is only by Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that this man casts out demons. And so the context indicates that Jesus is speaking about a sin that is not simply unbelief or rejection of Christ, but one that includes, firstly, a clear knowledge of who Christ is and the power of the Holy Spirit working through him. Secondly, a willful rejection of the facts about Christ that has his appearance, opponents knew to be true. It was hard to deny what Jesus was doing there. And thirdly, slanderously attributing the work of the Holy Spirit to the power of Satan, saying that this is the work of Satan, as the Pharisees had done. And so in such a case of hardness of heart, it would be so great that any ordinary means of bringing a sinner to repentance would already have been rejected. Persuasion of the truth will not work for these people who have known the truth and willfully rejected it. And so these Pharisees knew the truth. They'd seen what Jesus was doing, and they willfully rejected any possibility of this being from God. And they hardened their hearts. The fact that the unpardonable sin involves such extreme hardness of heart and lack of repentance indicates that those who fear they have committed it, yet still have sorrow for sin in their hearts and desire to seek after God, certainly do not fall into this category of those who are guilty of it. And so a famous commentator, Burkhoff, said that we may reasonably be sure that those who fear that they have committed it and worry about this and desire the prayers of others for them have not committed it. And it seems really, really a shame that so many people have lived in fear, worrying about this particular sin with no reason to. If you are concerned about this, it means that your heart hasn't hardened beyond returning to God. And we all make mistakes. We all often turn our backs on the Lord. But this is a willful hardening of heart and rejection. And that become become so hard that there's no turning back. And so that's what it seems to be like, Jesus is saying in this very context. If we treat the work of the Holy Spirit as the Pharisees were doing, just a willful rejection and defiance, is that we run the risk of that. But anyone who is not in that boat, you can rest assured. And God's heart is always for people to turn to him. Know that that's God's default position. So don't worry. And Satan wants you to be so worried about this that you take your eyes off of his mission, which is to go and make new disciples. And so he's made this such a distraction. And we know that the Spirit testifies that we're God's children. That's an amazing promise, that the Spirit testifies that we're adopted children. And so we read the word of the God. It says those who have the Spirit are children of God. And so God's Spirit witnesses to our spirit that we're children of God. If you know that, you have every assurance. So I'd encourage you, it's good to study these things, but don't do that to detriment of missing out on the important things that God wants us to do as his children, and to go out and to reach others, and to live the way he wants to be doing, not living paranoid and almost schizophrenic every day. Am I saved? Am I not saved? That's not what God wants for you or me. So be confident. Semi-final point of make on that is some people have looked at what John the Apostle said about a sin that leads to death. And I don't think that Jesus talking about, or Paul's talking about this, sorry. I don't think that John is talking about the same thing here as Jesus. He can be talking about doctrinal error, which John is doing in his letter. But it's still, at the end of it, that sin can still lead to death unless you seek forgiveness. It's not, a hardening situation as Jesus is talking about here. And so right at the end, even if someone has a doctrinal error, they can still repent of that right to the end. So that's again, not to be worried about. It's good to study, but don't be paranoid or actually terrified, because terror doesn't come from God. Perfect love drives out fear. So remember that. And so just as a warning today, as we read this, I love what it says in the letter to Hebrews. It's a bit sad, but very poignant. And there the writer says, as he talks about the failure of the Israelites to get into the promised land on time, he says, we also have had the gospel preached to us just as they did, but the message that they heard was of no value to them because those who heard it did not combine it with faith. And so that was happening in the time of Joshua. These Pharisees, these Jewish leaders were not, they were hearing the message, but weren't willing to combine that with faith. And so that's what we need to do. And so we need to respond in faith. We trust God. We sometimes, spend so much time worrying about our eternal security that we will lose sight of what God has for us. And so we need to combine that message, trusting God that he will walk with us, that he will lead us, that he will change us. And so we're called to go out and make disciples, show the love of Jesus through that. And that's an outward focus in our mission to those who do not know the Lord. Not be consumed with our eternal security all the time. Hardened hearts, however, will often equate to walking around with both our ears and our eyes closed. And so just touching on hardened hearts and how it applies to us today, is Jesus will again warn in the next chapter, I think chapter 13, about Israelites having a history of having hardened hearts, and that their ears and will be closed and their eyes will be closed. And so the dangers of a hardened heart I cannot underestimate. And so please, my prayer is often is that God would keep my heart soft. And I know Julie prays that prayer too. That should be all a prayer for all of us. Some of the things that might happen to us in terms of having hardened hearts. One is that we can be filled with bitterness and rage. And it says in Ephesians 4 to soak in God's truth, concerning bitterness and resentment. Because Paul says, get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger and slander. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as God forgave us in Christ. And so it's really important that we don't allow bitterness and rage to harden our hearts. We can also become isolated because we can grow angry and bitter. And so we tend to avoid people. And a clue for this includes people just avoiding one another with whom that they are upset with and turning away from the church. I've been upset by the church. The church let me down. And then often distance themselves from God or anything to do with him. Now, the church is a work in progress. We are not perfect. Only Jesus is perfect. And so we have to remember that our faith is in him and not the church. And so, well, it's important that we don't isolate ourselves. We need one another. We can't love one another, follow Jesus' command, other than by being together in fellowship. Hardened hearts can also lead to a refusal to forgive. Have you ever met someone who felt they were wronged and refused to forgive the offending party? That's a sign of a hardened heart. And we can all fall prey to that if we're not careful. And I remember just seeing someone from an extended family like that couldn't forgive. And over the years, their face became bitter and embittered. And you could see it contorted because they weren't able to get rid of that bitterness and forgive it. And it impacts us. Others, a hardened heart, may cause us to be indifferent. And then indifference can be an indicator of a hardened heart. Some folks themselves are shut down to God, the church, the Bible, even other people. Just remember David Peters' message about the gospel last week. This is really serious things. The biggest question of our lives is, are we right with God? Are we walking right with him? Don't be indifferent. This is the biggest question of your lives. If we find ourselves or a loved one living with indifference, recognize the warning signs first. It's not a safe place. Then talk with someone who can offer some godly counsel. Pray and be honest to God. God already knows your situation. You're not going to surprise God with anything. Another thing that can have hardness of heart is pride. If we find ourselves or a loved one living with indifference, recognize that warning sign first. And we need to humble ourselves and trust in the Lord. And the pride goes before the fall. It's the first sin in the Bible. And Jesus says, I give grace to the humble, but I oppose the pride. And pride leads to a hardened heart. Which is the final one. People sometimes with a hardened heart refuse to serve or to be ministered to. And Jesus ministered to singles and the masses. He served many, and miracles happened. Lives were changed. And can you imagine missing out on that opportunity? And it's still available today. Often a hardened heart will cause us to do just that. We'll refuse to serve. We'll refuse being ministered to. And we'll miss out on Jesus' miracles working today through the Holy Spirit. And with David and Greta here last week, we've talked a lot about that and shared many stories of the Holy Spirit being at work and ministering, setting people free. And I said, I've heard of stories coming of people coming to faith in their 90s. Tragically, I've heard stories we all know, even in our church, of people where lives have been cut tragically short. Tomorrow is not promised to anyone. No, we heard the gospel last week, again, reminded of that. You don't know what their week ahead holds, but I encourage you, trust in the Lord, humble yourselves. He will give you the grace to soften your hearts, and he wants you to be his children, to walk in that. So do not be afraid. And so I found here, as I was thinking about these, just a reminder from Proverbs, which is just some of those important truths. Just here from Proverbs 4:20 and reading. My children, pay attention to what I say. Listen closely to my words. Do not let them out of your sight and keep them within your heart. For they are life to those who find them and health to one's whole body. Above all, Guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Put away perversity from your mouth and keep corrupt talk far from your lips. Let your eyes look straight ahead. Fix your gaze directly before you. Make level paths for your feet and take only the ways that are firm. Do not swerve to the right or to the left. Keep your foot from evil. And that's all part about guarding our hearts from hardness. And in a sense, Jesus shows that in the next few verses. We won't read them right now, but Jesus says that out of the wellspring, out of the heart, will come our words. And our words come out of whatever is already in our hearts. And so if there's good things in the hearts, good things come out. You know, especially in those moments when we're surprised, not expecting something. And bad things will come out of our hearts if that's what's stored in there. And so it's really important that we protect our hearts. When we do that, we have every assurance of who we are, who our Father is, and what he has for us to do now and for our eternal security. And so let that spur you on to good works. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, we want to thank you for the ministry of Jesus, that God became flesh and ministered to his people. We thank you, Lord, that we experience that today. We know your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, that he has poured your love into our hearts. And Lord, we pray that we would continually be filled with your Spirit to walk in your ways. Lord, if anyone here is grappling with a hardened heart, Lord, or fear, I pray, Lord, that they will just humble themselves and seek you and ask for tender hearts. And Lord, you love to bless people who come to you seeking your grace and humility. And I pray that many will be set free again by seeking you. And Lord, we know that the same sun, Lord, that melts butter can harden mud out in desert areas. And Father, we ask in your grace that you'll be melting hearts like butter as we speak now. And Lord, we know that your word does not return void. So may your Spirit speak into the hearts of everyone here today. And may we glorify your name. We thank you for our love for us, Lord. And may we walk in your ways each and every day for your kingdom and your glory. We thank you and bless you. Amen. Thank you. And hopefully we'll be meeting in person next week. But a lot can happen in a week. So keep trusting, keep loving, and keep honouring him. Hallelujah. And keep loving one another too. Amen. And thank you.
For our time of prayer this morning, I'm going to throw up some points on the screen, and just encourage you to take time with whoever you're with and to pray through those. Thank you. Hey, can I pray for us and just close with a benediction out of Jude? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time that we've had together, Lord. You know us all intimately. You know what's going on in our lives and what each of us is facing right now. And so, Father, we lift ourselves to you. Father, all of our good, all of our bad, all of our strength, all of our weakness, Father, and we just want to lay it before you. And we ask, Lord, that you would come and you would let us, Holy Spirit, fill each of us, that we might know the fruit of the spirits, the fruit of the Spirit, and see the evidence of that in our lives. And just ask you, if you're comfortable, raise your hands as I pray out of Jude 24. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling or falling into sin, and to present you unblemished, blameless, and faultless in the presence of his glory with triumphant joy and unspeakable delight, to the only God our Saviour, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power before all time, now and forever. Amen. God bless, fam. See you later.